So that's really another one of our challenges, which is another thing about not being a scientist and being a CEO, is how do we make this affordable for all farmers, right? Because they want it, right? And it's not about, you know, how much can we get them to pay for it, because it has to be within their price point. Otherwise, they're not going to buy it, because they're really operating on tight margins because they have a biomass problem.
Hey, what's up, everyone? John Stenstrom here from the Cast and Spirit podcast. And today we have Dr. Suzan Shahrestani, the CEO of Minnotech. I brought her on because I was really interested in what it's like to start a tech company in the fisheries space. And what she's doing is really cool. She basically has a novel camera and software that's able to see and count shrimp through muddy water, which is pretty futuristic. So I wanted to pick her brain on A, what it's like to get a PhD in the fisheries space, B, what kind of crazy technologies are coming our way, and see what it's like to actually start a tech company in this space, the incubator process. I went through one in the past for my old startup, and I wanted to share that experience with you in case you're ever interested in starting up a startup. So without further ado, please welcome Dr. Shahrestani.
So my name is Suzan Shahrestani. I'm a marine scientist and a CEO of a shrimp counting startup. I got a couple of fancy letters, CEO and PhD, but it's really about what I'm doing as a scientist and trying to leverage my research into the aquaculture industry.
So what did you originally get your PhD in?
So I'm originally a fisheries scientist. I was using sonar technology to count jellyfish in the Chesapeake Bay. So essentially, you know, we've been using nets as marine scientists to collect data, but my PhD was really about the application of state-of-the-art technology that was developed for the Navy to try to see how we could fill in data gaps. So assessing jellyfish, where they are, what they were doing, and how they were affecting the local fish populations in the Chesapeake Bay. That's the fisheries part, really.
I think many of my listeners would be like, how the heck, what kind of technology is this magic?
Yeah,
can you go into a little,
really
go
cool.
into it a little bit?
Sure.
Is it like computer vision? Sure. Is it machine learning? Like, what is it?
It's all of the above, actually. So the idea was that, you know, the water in Chesapeake Bay is really dirty. So you can't put cameras in the water that use light. You wouldn't be able to see 2 inches ahead of you. I think about 20 or 30 years ago, there was a technology developed for the Navy that then became commercialized. And what it does is it's kind of expensive, but it produces really, really high resolution data using sonar. And so you could actually see things that you weren't able to see before when you were using a fish finder of sorts, right? So these are images. And so I put that camera in the water, not to look for pipelines or kind of as a rescue device, but to assess, you know, what was going on under there. And we saw a lot of incredible things for the first time. And then, so now we have had this huge data set of images, sonar images of the Chesapeake Bay, tributaries in the Chesapeake Bay. I was looking for jellyfish, but I was seeing things like beautiful schools of menhaden, small troops of shrimp, stingrays, all these beautiful things, you know, eels feeding at night. Nobody knew I was taking footage because they're totally unaware that they're being captured by sonar. And so I had millions and millions of images, which posed a logistical challenge as far as how do we now collect data? And that's really where the machine learning and computer vision came in, because instead of me having to count millions of jellyfish, I essentially taught a computer to go through individual frames and count the jellyfish for me. And I then had in my hands this really unprecedented data set of not only a count, visualizations of jellyfish, their individual patterns in the water column, but also their location, the time at which I was recording. So really a robust data set on jellyfish that became kind of like a place for me to explore and truly try to understand really what was the necessary data I need to draw valuable conclusions to get a PhD. So it was a really interesting experience. I had no coding knowledge. I was kind of came into the PhD, didn't know really what machine learning was, and came out loving that stuff. And that's really what's kind of the secret sauce of the company.
That's impressive. Do we know if people are using similar types of technology for other types of fish? Because, I mean, I've had conversations with anglers and people who are kind of like in fishing, wildlife, that kind of stuff, you know. And I think a lot of people are still in the nets capturing stage of thinking, whereas there's so much other technology that's, you know, pretty prevalent in other industries. And I like how you're bringing it to, you know, the fisheries. But do we know if there's anybody using this, or is it like jellyfish was kind of the original project and we just don't know?
No, there are. Up in Alaska, especially on the West Coast, they're using it in salmon runs. And so what they do is essentially set up these high definition cameras, and they know salmon are coming through. And so they'll count the salmon as they come through. The camera is being used a lot. But what's different about what we did with the jellyfish was we incorporated the machine learning and computer vision technology, which you really have to customize to each species. So the learning curve to jump from, okay, I'm putting the camera in the water, and then I'm looking at the footage afterwards, and I'm manually counting these fish, to, okay, how do I teach a computer? That's a pretty steep learning curve. And I think that not enough has gone into that, but I would say that that is the direction. I mean, it's unavoidable, in my opinion.
That's awesome. So now you took all this knowledge, and then now you're applying it to, you know, addressing food shortage. How are you doing that?
Sure. So right after my PhD, I realized I had this really valuable skill set. I knew that I had learned so much about fisheries, recognizing that it was a finite resource. And all of these things started to come together and point me towards aquaculture. I had met my partner, Ken Malone, who had heard of this problem within the shrimp industry, where it was a similar problem that I was addressing in my PhD. You asked me about food shortage, and I kind of went on a different tangent.
No, that's
come back to food shortage.
Oh yeah, yeah. Let's first segue into kind of like how you got started with Minnotech, because I don't even think we've mentioned Minnotech yet.
Oh, okay. You want to do that?
Sure. Yeah, yeah. Let's do that, and then we'll circle back to addressing the food shortage.
Okay.
All right. So that's all fascinating. I would love to know kind of how, you know, you took that kind of technology and, you know, created a startup in this space.
Sure. It was around my fourth year of my PhD where I was kind of looking to have a larger impact with this skill set that I had, understanding that it was a new tool to observe marine resources. And then now you could use the technology that like computer vision and machine learning and apply it and create these beautiful data sets. So that was I had that skill set to solve problems that were facing that challenge. How do we get better data? And so I was looking for a problem, really. I had a solution and I was looking for a problem. And so I joined an entrepreneur program for my grad school out of the Institute of Marine and Environmental Technology in Baltimore, Maryland. And it was called a reef program. And I met my partner, Ken Malone, who is a mentor. He heard me talk about my research and he said, do you think you can count shrimp in aquaculture? Because he had connections and he had known that it was the same problem that I was facing in the Chesapeake Bay. Dirty water, invertebrates, there are so many of them. We can't use nets to count them because it's very inaccurate. How do we solve this problem? And so I was like, if I can count jellyfish in the Chesapeake Bay, I'm pretty sure I can count shrimp in an aquaculture pond, which was, you know, enclosed, and I knew the volume of it. And all of these things became standardized that were really challenges for my PhD work. And so I could really leverage my PhD research to address this problem. So I had essentially found my problem. And in, I would say, a week, we started the company, and we actually joined a global accelerator in aquaculture. And I kind of it put us through the grinder, and you know, we were developing prototypes, and I was traveling the world, and within 2 months I had a prototype in the water, and we were kind of off and running to continue to engage with our customers and understand the problem more. And again, you know, we have the technology, but now we really want to nail it, right? We want to get it right. So that's kind of how the startups, that's our origin story.
That's impressive. What? How old is your company right now?
So we're 2 years old. Well, I'd say a year and a half. We founded February 2018.
And for everybody listening, that's Minnotech.
2017.
Right?
Minnotech. Yeah, Minnotech.
So what's it like being a CEO?
Oh, man. It's been a challenge. You know, I still identify as a scientist. You know, and there's a definite transition that you have to go through as a scientist. You know, everything is so rigorous, but and you kind of you're allowed to go down these dead ends and explore. And your time is kind of part of the whole experience, right? You're allowed to dedicate time to things as you're really trying to do your research. But when you're an entrepreneur and when you become a CEO, like your time just changes. You have to recognize and prioritize where you're putting your time. And as a scientist, and I love the tech, and I just want to throw all my time into that, right? But no, I've learned that actually me engaging with customers is so much more valuable. And I've actually felt that transition, or I'm still feeling that transition of moving from, you know, the PhD to the CEO. But I like it. I think it's exciting. I get to wear many hats. I get to, you know, meet so many different types of people. And really move quickly. I think that's what I like the most. You know, Minnotech gets to move as fast as I do, and I like to move fast. So I think it's pretty cool.
Well, that's awesome. I'm glad you started your startup. Minnotech sounds amazing. But how are you going to now tackle like the big problem, you know, that aquaculture is a lot of people are kind of touting as trying to address this huge food shortage that, you know, we're all kind of experiencing on a global scale?
Sure. At the end of the day, I think that we are trying to address world hunger. Hunger is a big issue. I think that, you know, people can't think when they're hungry. And right now, there's about 1 billion people that don't have access to food or food security, rather. And so what we're trying to do is essentially optimize how we grow food to catch up with the expected population growth. Right now, we're not going to make it with the way we're growing animals on land, and everybody's turning to aquaculture because it's so efficient. It is one of the most efficient ways of growing food. You know, there's no bycatch if you're talking about marine life. It's lower greenhouse gas emissions. To me, it is the future of food. And so I really like shrimp, because it's also one of those species to grow that are very efficient to grow. And they also have a really short life cycle. So it means that you can grow them rather quickly. And so now it's our duty to kind of shape the growth of aquaculture by incorporating technology that's already been used in agriculture on land. You know, dairy farmers and cattle ranchers are using AI systems. They're using drones, but shrimp farmers are using nets, and they're really, really inaccurate. So it's about creating a technological infrastructure for a growing industry and providing them with the data they need to really make the entire supply chain much more robust. And that will have implications for improved production, right? Intensification is something in aquaculture. How do we grow more in less space? Better nutrition. How do we put less energy in and get more energy out, or more efficient energy in, rather, and get better energy out as far as, you know, your food conversion ratios when you're talking about growing animals. And so I think that, you know, Minnotech's challenge right now is to address the data gaps that exist, because there really hasn't been much attention paid to aquaculture in underdeveloped countries, especially in the tropical regions where a lot of aquaculture is going to take place.
When it comes to aquaculture, see, I'm on the fence, because it's like I have people that I really respect who believe in it super, like a whole, like, it's going to change the world. But then I also hear the other side of the equation where it's like, have you seen that documentary of Artificial?
Yes.
Like, what are your...
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, go ahead.
Continue.
No, I was just curious on, like, you have this other camp who are like, you know, the whole reason why we're in a lot of this climate change stuff is because, you know, we're always trying to play God or, you know, whatnot, trying to pack as get as much efficiency out of animals and stuff like that. Whereas we kind of need to let the nature breathe or whatnot. And we should have more of a wild fishery or et cetera. Like, what are your thoughts on like the other side of the equation? for the people who aren't really into aquaculture might think it's a bad thing. Because I mean, like the people who, for example, you know, tuna pens are a disaster. They're an ecological disaster because of all the poop in one spot. And they, you know, people don't manage the downstream effects as efficiently as they could. So I'm just curious on like your thoughts on the counter argument to aquaculture.
Sure. I'm happy the counter argument exists because it's a challenge to really make things better. I don't disagree that tuna pens are not necessarily a good thing. There are more efficient species to grow as far as a food source. So there are parts of aquaculture that are more, you know, geared towards satisfying the consumer market. And maybe those parts of it, yeah, you know, people can challenge that and ask them to be better. And then there are also parts of it that are, you know, trying to be better and for the sake, or are focusing more rather on food, right? So how do we grow more efficiently as a protein source? So within aquaculture, you know, it's very, there are different types of species that are grown for different reasons. And I guess the idea is for me that aquaculture is going to happen. We are going to need to grow more food as long as there's a demand for it.
I like this kind of conversation because it's not just like cookie cutter. Like we're actually thinking on the fly. I'm like, wait a second.
Yeah, I'm trying to think a little bit. I mean, I like alarmists. I like people on the other side that are essentially saying, hey, aquaculture is bad. Look at all these bad things, and essentially shining a light on where we need to improve. I think for me, I know that there are a lot of challenges with shrimp farming, but sitting back and just pointing at them and saying there are challenges is not going to stop shrimp farming at all, right? It's about how do we get in there and improve it and optimize it and make it better. So the challenging voices is nice. I know that sounds strange, but it is. And I agree with a lot of it. I'm not sitting here saying aquaculture, you know, is the answer to everything. There will be problems, but I'm hoping that, you know, the kind of the buzz around it right now will help innovate to solve those challenges before they get worse.
No, that makes a lot of sense. So for Minnotech, for example, and you have this really great technology that works for the specific use case, are you going to, is like your goal in the next 2 to 5 years to be the technology for every shrimp farm in the world? Or is it like you want to use this technology for different species or different applications? Or like, how do you guys work as a business, you know, to expand?
Sure. I like to say that, you know, we can see in both clear and dirty water, so we're not really limited. Right now we're focused on shrimp farming because we know how to do it. And, you know, we just want to maintain a focus on one species, but we are looking at other species that grow in dirty water, like catfish, which, you know, that's a Southern American fishery or aquaculture. They grow them in ponds similar to shrimp. And there are also crabs that we can assess based with just a few modifications to our technology. So we are looking to expand into other species, but we're really focusing on shrimp because the need is just tremendous.
Well, I'm sure there's a lot there around the world to tackle before world domination kind of thing. Do you see any other crazy technologies that are setting aquaculture up to be like the way of the future outside of your own? I mean, yours is already cutting edge, but is there other stuff that you're seeing trends that are worth mentioning?
Sure. I think the nutrition, feed additives, those, you know, finding new ways and new raw materials to put into feed to improve the efficiency of growth. There's a lot of creative things happening there. And also breeding and genetics. Also, you know, trying to optimize species, finding new species, exploring, you know, the ocean and seeing which fish grow the best with the right food. You know, it's all about how do we find the broiler chicken of the sea and do much better. So I think there are definitely, and as far as technology innovations go, computer vision, machine learning, all of that is, especially in Norway with salmon, they're really leading the cause for technological infrastructure. I know that they're even doing facial recognition to detect stress on salmon. There's a sea lice problem in Norway in those open pens. And so they're also using computer vision to locate them on the body and laser them off. Just a lot of really interesting things as well with the offshore pens, just the engineering behind them. All of those, you know, there's a lot of innovation happening globally. I think that's also a really interesting thing for the aquaculture industry and the startup landscape in itself, is that people are coming from all over the world. There's not a central location like Silicon Valley, if you will. I think the closest thing would be Bergen, Norway, but because of the salmon industry, you see CEOs and scientists and engineers scratching their heads and trying to come up with solutions. And the diversity of it within that is also makes it quite exciting and kind of a hotbed for innovation. So the innovations that are coming, I'm excited about. I think that they're all brewing right now.
What I'd like to take the conversation is, I've been through an incubator, you know, I've had a startup in the past, but I think a lot of our listeners might be curious. It might just not even be on their radar. And I think the incubation program that you went through is very unique. And I'm even just really would love to know more about it. How does one, for example, say they have an idea and they want to change, they want to help make the world a better place and, you know, get into sustainable fisheries or this kind of field. What was it like? Can you give us kind of like a play-by-play of, you know, from when you had the idea and you're looking for, you know, to start the business to when you got into the incubator, what that process was like and some of the lessons you learned?
Oh, definitely. So essentially, it was like I had mentioned before, I knew I had a skill set and I understood what it meant for people that couldn't count their animals in dirty water. But it was actually meeting the right people that understood the problem. And that was the accelerator in itself. And so it was coming together, the accelerator, there were a lot of key people in the accelerator that had been to countless shrimp farmers, had spoken to so many shrimp farmers, and that was all information I didn't have. And then there were my business partners who had more of an understanding of the startup world. So for me, really, the company started when the right minds came together. We all had a piece of what needed to kind of create the larger picture. And once we understood what the roles of everybody were going to be, then it was, okay, now let's test this idea that we all have together. And that's really what the accelerator was. So you apply for the accelerator, either you have a prototype or you have an idea, you have a team that is really dedicated but has a skill set to achieve something or to tackle a problem. All of, you know, there are many different ways that you can go into the accelerator or into a program like that. But it really depends, you know, what they look at is the team. Can they actually accomplish what they say they're going to accomplish? And then their end, if they understand that there's a need, then it's really, it's just a match. And so that happened for us. We matched with Hatch, which is a global, the world's first aquaculture accelerator. I had many conversations with the CEO, COO, and kind of just how are we going to do this? And then within 2 weeks, I was on a flight to Ireland to enter their program with an idea and with the problem. So with the solution, but not a prototype, but an idea for the problem. And so it really was a matter of putting that idea through all of their tests, right? And I don't mean tests like, you know, you're taking an exam, but can you stand up and can you pitch this idea? Can you make people in your that we're introducing to you understand your idea? Do they believe that you are the person that can accomplish it? And so you start to try to build credibility, not only for your idea, but for yourself and for your team. And so I think that the accelerator was really where I began to understand that I was, you know, I was a scientist and that was valuable, but it was more valuable that I would be able to communicate my vision for the company to those around me, to investors or to potential partners or to an audience, right? Just be able to communicate my vision. And that's really what I learned through the accelerator. And then I think the other thing that was really remarkable was meeting my customers. So we started in Ireland, and that was really where I was building the prototype out of a makerspace in one of their national labs with my partner, Kevin, at the time. And we were going through, every day you're talking to people from all over the world that are just huge in aquaculture or in startup, in the startup community, and you're learning and you're taking notes and you're asking questions and you're visiting aquaculture farms. You know, they just pack your day full of experiences and hope that you take from it what you need. And you take as much as you can, but you can't take all of it, right? There are some things that you have to say, okay, that's not really relevant to me. So I'm going to have to stand back and really learn how to manage my time in that way. My best experience from the whole accelerator was when I finally got to test my prototype in a farm in Medan, Indonesia, in a shrimp farm. I threw it in the water. It did not work, but it completely reshaped how I was going to approach the second prototype. And so just a bunch of mistakes and learning experiences and, you know, few successes when you come out of an accelerator, but it should shape the company, I think, and really point you in the direction where you need to be effective.
How long is the Hatch program?
It's 3 months.
And where was it located?
So my cohort, I was part of the second cohort. It was 2 months in Ireland. We spent 2 weeks in Bergen, Norway. We spent a week in Singapore and 5 days in Indonesia. The most recent cohort spent a month in Big Island, Hawaii, out of the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii, NELHA. And then they spent a month in Bergen, Norway, and a month in Singapore.
Well, I definitely picked the wrong incubator. I want to travel that much.
Yeah.
I got stuck in Chinatown in San Francisco with rats in it. Yeah. So, yours is way better.
Yeah. I know. I'm in Hawaii right now, so I got to overlap with the last cohort. That was a lot of fun.
Now, after you go through the 3 months, do you have some kind of demo day where it's like you built out your minimum viable product, you know, you learn, get all these learnings, and then you had to pitch and see if you get make money, or how did that work?
Yeah. So I think it was our last day. We were pitching in Dublin. And just as you described, all the companies, you know, pitch their company to a room full of investors and essentially are telling them, hey, this is how far we've come. This is who we are. This is what you need. This is what we need. And this is what you need. Can you, help us? And a lot comes from that.
So after you finished demo day, like this, from my own experience, it was like after the incubator was over, it's like, oh, the training wheels are off. You have to go into the real world and go do what you like set out to do. What was that transition like? Because I remember for myself having, you know, you have all these other startups who are all kind of going through different stages in their journey, but we're all relatively trying to figure some stuff out. So it felt kind of like a sort of family in a sense for a couple months.
Oh, yeah.
But then you have to go out into the world and you went out to the Big Island. Like, what got you there from when the incubator, what was it like to the transition of like running it yourself?
Sure. I think, you know, right afterwards, you kind of slow down, your progress slows down a little bit because you're not immersed in that go, go, go energy. For me, that definitely happened. The COO of Hatch calls it post-accelerator syndrome because he notices that companies kind of have to sit back a little bit and understand all of their experiences and distill it down to something that's manageable enough to tackle on your own, right? I think you hit the nail on the head where the training wheels are off and now, you know, you're on your own and it's time to go. I'm never on my own. I have fantastic partners that are kind of experienced or are experienced in the startup world. But it was definitely a little bit of a slowdown. What really kicked it off for us was we received an NSF SBIR, which is a small business research grant from the National Science Foundation. And that was a grant. And we got grant money to essentially, conduct research in Hawaii. So we knew what the next part of our technological development needed to be. We wanted to be our research. We wanted our research to be in the U.S. Hawaii is one of the only location, one of the very few locations in the U.S. If not the only one that can grow shrimp all year round. There are some shrimp farms in Texas, and now you'll start to see different types of RAS or in-house systems or on-land shrimp systems in the mainland U.S. But Hawaii was really where we needed to test our product continuously to be, for me to be in Hawaii and just have access, continuous access to shrimp. And so we applied for a grant and we got it. And that was really a tremendous day for us. We felt like we were off and running. Now we have the funds, we had the means, we had the resources to really tackle the technological development of our device. And that's what I'm doing right now.
Well, congratulations. Getting an SBIR is not easy. And they take forever.
No, it's not. Yes, they do.
So congrats on that. How long did it take to get one?
So we started the application of September of 2018. The year, I'm like, is it 2020? We started the application in 2017 and we were awarded, I think about 9 to 10 months later and received our grant money this past year. So it takes about a year to, once you submit, to actually kind of getting the resources and being able to implement them.
Well, the nice part about it is it's non-dilutive, right? So it's actually just, here's some cash, go deliver on your promise.
Yes.
Awesome.
Yes,
are you going to try and get the second phase?
Yep. I'm actually going to a workshop next week in Oahu to help us prepare for the application for the second phase.
That's fantastic. I hope you get it. I hope you, isn't there also one? Isn't there another one called STTR?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. There's so many hidden gems out there if you just know where to look.
Yes, there is.
Was the actual application hard to make, or was it pretty standard?
I think it depends. You know, I had written or had been on proposals before for the NSF, but it was more from the research angle to do our research. You know, in Chesapeake Bay, some research in the Arctic, but this was different because you really had to understand your customers and, you know, prove that you had spoken to enough customers that this was actually a problem. I think that it is quite challenging, actually, especially for an early startup, because you're having to condense what you think, or you're having to, you know, tease apart what you think is important from what is actually important. And that can be challenging for a startup that thinks everything is important. So it was quite challenging, I would say.
Well, here's a question that's on my mind. How do you bring a pretty much like black boxy type of technology that might seem like magic to the everyday person and then convince them that, you know, to try it? So say, for example, it's like you have fish, shrimp farmers who have been doing probably the same method for 50-100 years, if not longer, and now you're trying to kind of come in and change it up. What's it been like talking to these farmers?
I think talking to the farmers has probably been the greatest motivation, because they really, really want a solution. They face this problem so much that there's almost a level of desperation for something better, and there just hasn't been. I'm really intrigued by millennial farmers in Indonesia. These are farmers that have, you know, they're computer savvy and, you know, research on the internet and are looking for solutions, who have taken over their father's or their parents' farms. And now they're saying, hey, we can do this better. What's online? I get reached out to, they reach out to me very frequently, all the time, actually. And I can talk to farmers about their problems a lot. And the excitement that there could be even a potential solution. And, you know, they're kind of like, if you could do this, that would be amazing. And I'm like, yes, I know, let's do this, right? So it's kind of very exciting. I think, yeah, that's definitely one of my favorite things. And I think that's why we are so focused on really solving this problem. It's the feedback from our customers. We know that they are ready. They want something better. And of course, you have, you know, farms that will maybe not be able to invest or invest in the product. And so that's really another one of our challenges, which is another thing about not being a scientist and being a CEO, is how do we make this affordable for all farmers, right? Because they want it, right? And it's not about, you know, how much can we get them to pay for it, because it has to be within their price point. Otherwise, they're not going to buy it, because they're really operating on tight margins because they have a biomass problem. So we really have to kind of find our way in there to help essentially solve this problem, even though they're really pretty excited about it.
That's awesome. Are there any other applications that you see this kind of like computer vision type stuff for, like the everyday angler, like the recreational angler, or is it all, you think, going to be more so in the commercial side of things?
No, I definitely think that there's room for computer vision and machine learning and digital data collection, if you will. Actually, you know, when I was going through the graduate school program, I had developed a product as part of the exercise to essentially address the data gaps in recreational fisheries, where I was trying to essentially teach your smartphone how to size, identify the species of a fish. And so if you're out and you're an angler and you catch a fish, you know, you pull it up, you put it on your boat deck or on the pier, and you snap a photo of it. And now all of a sudden you have all of this data logged with just a snap of a picture, you know, your size of your fish, your species of your fish, where you caught that fish. Hey, what was the weather like when I caught it? And that really was to function for, had two purposes. The first was to give feedback to the angler, which, and I thought in itself would be educational, just to have a more in-depth understanding and provide anglers with user-friendly data interpretation, right? In a new way, kind of, but also it would have served as a channel to feed recreational fisheries data, because I believe that's essentially, that's a really huge problem, how we collect data for recreational fisheries.
I want that app. Make it happen. Give us that app. I think we all want it.
Yes, I know. I'm working on that too.
The real hack would be is if you can get some kind of, like, say, California Fish and Wildlife to pay anglers to take the pictures, to gather the data that gets then given to the scientists. They're almost kind of like citizen scientists doing a good thing, and you can make sure that people aren't using the same fish over and over again, because through computer vision, you can see that, you know, that this is a unique identified fish, you know, just based on its scales and patterns and stuff like that. But it's like, that it would be my dream, because then it's like, you have incentive to not only brag about what you catch, but then you actually get to show in real time what's actually being caught, and people are incentivized to do it. That'd be interesting.
You know, we are looking for somebody to spearhead that project. Oh,
one day. We could talk offline about it.
Yeah, exactly.
That's crazy. You're doing some really cutting edge stuff. How does one? I have a lot of friends who, you know, ever since I started this like project and website, it's kind of opening their minds to, you know, go away from just maybe the fintech industry or whatever in programming into more of these kinds of like sustainability type companies. How does one either A, get started, like follow your path, or B, find companies similar to yours? Or yours, you know, how do people find these things?
So, I mean, I think for me, just based on how I've been found or how people have reached out to me, is, you know, social media, you know, following, if you're interested in aquaculture, then following a group like Hatch. Hatch will always, you know, retweet what their portfolio companies are doing. These are all growing companies that are looking to hire people, to bring on people with experience and expertise and passion, really, for the aquaculture industry, or for, you know, feeding, you know, growing more food and feeding the world's growing population. So kind of tapping into personalities, people that are interested in those things, and groups that are organizing around those things. Another group is Fish 2.0. They're also bringing in people working in that industry, in the fishing industry, anything really having to do with fish and trying to improve marine resources and conservation. So I think finding kind of the top, that is then, there are many smaller companies that are involved with, like, demo days and pitch competitions, and following them on LinkedIn and Twitter and Facebook, because they're always reposting. That's how we get our word out. You know, if we have a job posting, we'll put it out that way because we are very niche. And so we're disseminating the information within a community. So tapping into that community is really what will help you. The global aquaculture advocate, they always are, you know, up to date on what's happening within the aquaculture startup community and just aquaculture in general. So finding those resources, I think, is the best way.
Do you have any books or other podcasts or anything that outside of what you just mentioned that's worth sharing?
So I'm currently reading Measure What Matters. And it essentially talks about just that. How do you prioritize your time to address what matters? How do you come up with achievable goals and then essentially key results that are affiliated with those goals to kind of track your progress? The most difficult thing for me, what I do is essentially time management, but not necessarily, you know, how many hours in the day do I work, but how many hours do I dedicate to this? How do I prioritize what really moves the company forward? So I think from a business perspective, that's what I'm reading. I don't really read or listen to, I don't want to say that I don't listen to podcasts much. That's mean.
No. I mean, you don't, that's actually interesting because, you know, I have some PhD friends who are always like head first in a book. So it's refreshing to have somebody who's like, oh, I don't read that much. I just go do.
I really don't. Yeah. I know it's kind of, and I it's interesting to me because, you know, a book will, I read for fun, right? Like, I read fiction and stuff like that. But when it comes to reading, it's mostly research papers, reports, that kind of thing, dry reading, if you will. But yeah, I'm not much into podcasts and kind of nonfiction.
How do people find out or reach you? How do people reach you?
Oh, sure. You can reach me if by email, suzan@minnotech.com. You can also reach me. I'm on LinkedIn. You could reach out to me there. We're also on Twitter, and I like to follow the Twitter. So any three of those ways.
Awesome. Is there any parting advice you can give our listeners?
You know, science, as a scientist, I've always found science to be beautiful. I've always been naturally curious. I think, though, that curiosity for a long time was very much a privilege. And now I feel more of a charged energy to, instead of kind of being motivated by the curiosity and the passion I have for science, to trying to move that into a passion for essentially trying to solve problems, especially within the environment, right? I'm an environmental scientist at heart. There's a reason I spend so many years of my life researching the environment. But I do, you know, there is a distress signal. And I do think now I feel that I am on the forefront of really answering that call. And so that's really what motivates me now. And that's really, I think, what has been the major transition as I move from a scientist to an entrepreneur.
Well, I guess I have one more question. Is what would you say to a climate denier?
Oh, I would tell them I've seen it. I think that, you know, I am not somebody that likes to throw out facts in people's faces. I don't think numbers sit with people. I think that, you know, numbers mean so much to me. You know, I'm a statistician. I love statistics and I see the world in numbers. But I think that a lot of people don't. And so for me, it's always trying to build this idea that, hey, I've been out there, right? I've walked the same pier for 5 or 6 years and I've seen the changes myself. And I know how to look at the data, you know, and understand that I actually, you know, have a job to do that, or, you know, became trained to do that. So it's really about, it's always a difficult conversation because to me, it's less about it's less of an argument and it's more of just, hey man, open your eyes just a little bit. You can see it. It's all around you. Just pay attention.
That's awesome. Well, thank you so much for sharing all of your startup journey and all the cool stuff that you've been up to. Really appreciate it. And I hope I'm definitely sure a lot of people have learned a lot from you today. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. That's so fantastic. I appreciate it.
Well, that does it for this episode of the podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. Big thank you to Dr. Shahrestani for sharing your wisdom and what it was like to start a company. And I hope you guys, if you have the entrepreneurial drive, start one yourself. So let's go to the reviews. I want to say a big thank you to The Cathalini, who says, just started getting into fishing, and this was both helpful and entertaining, enjoying the learning process with you. Thank you. I'm glad that you are listening, and I really appreciate it. If you want a shout out like this, please leave a comment and a review on Apple Podcasts. I read every single one of them, and let me know how I can make this podcast better for you. So with that, keep those lines tight, everyone. See ya.